I'll just get started here. So this super scar firm paper, doing pretty well with citation count here today. Probably will keep getting more. But this is pulled right out of the appendix. It's the for the retail trade sector. It's the top concentration of the top four firms at the national level, right? And you know, defined various ways, you just see this strong increase in concentration over recent decades. Okay, so this is the big trend that a lot of people are talking about. And well, Elizabeth Warren says if she wins, she wants to break up Amazon, right? And I think it's a good thing to try to understand why this trend is happening, right? And so this is the maybe the token micro paper in the conference, perhaps not teasing, right? Because macro is moving into micro, and I'm very happy to hear that.
Macro is one of the branches of applied micro.
Thank you. Yes, I 100% agree with that. But this is going to be, rather than sort of point and say fixed cost and so forth, what I'm trying to do with this paper is get sort of the nitty gritty to try to understand scale economies, right? And you know, this is going to be a kind of a Sutton paper, right? In the general sense that firms, you know, as they get bigger, they do different things. Their average cost is going down, but by the different things they're doing, they're actually lowering their marginal cost, right? And this is going to be, sort of a deep micro analysis of that for this sector. Okay, and to be honest, you can see it's been a trend for going on a little while, right? And so I'm sitting here, late 90s, right? Seeing this, of Walmart taking over the retail sector, right? And people were talking about barcodes, right? And Walmart is just adopting these new technologies. And I found it a little bit puzzling because I noticed my little kids in their school library, the school library is using barcodes, right? Why is this barcode something that's particular to Walmart? Okay, or excuse me, yeah, right. And so what I did, I have this paper I published in RAND, and it's an argument why these new technologies complement scale. Okay, and it's related to indivisibilities, right? So let's think about the small-time furniture store or clothing store, right, that may have still been around in the 1990s in some small town, right? And they've got these new technologies that come along. Oh, great. If we adopt barcodes and use them in our inventory system, we can, instead of having, delivery 2 weeks, to take advantage of this stuff, really, this updated information is only going to help if you have very frequent deliveries, right? Well, you're some furniture store or a clothing store in a small town. You don't sell enough in a day or a week or maybe even 2 weeks to justify that truck coming into town and dropping off your stuff. Okay? And the cost of that shipment is going to be the same whether the truck is in general the container that the truck is dragging is full, half full, quarter full. Okay? That's the indivisibility that we're focusing on here. Okay? And so what is a Walmart? What is the theory of a Walmart? A Walmart is a way to take that small town, and instead of having separate furniture, clothing, and so forth, have it all in one firm. And so when the truck is coming in, they have all the stuff, the diversity of merchandise that a Walmart will carry to solve an indivisibility problem. And by the way, why don't we just combine the retail sector or the small town with the small town next door and so forth to get really big scale, right? And so that's the theory. Now, this may beg a question, why aren't just intermediaries doing it? Why isn't just a FedEx truck coming in or UPS making a bunch of stops? So we'll come back to that. We say there's evidently some frictions, but we'll have more to say about
it. There are industries where it does. If you look at Cardinal Health, if you look at pharma distribution, they really are intermediaries that do exactly that.
Yes, there are. But I'm going to show some data where it's more limited than you think, as in general. So in specifically, this is a theory paper. Walmart's not very generous with sharing its data about what's on its trucks, right? And it just sort of put it aside. Okay? But then my research sort of evolved and I got interested in trade issues. And then I'm looking at trade data. My goodness, there's a lot of information if I look at this trade data. So what we have here is, I have this paper, and it's joined with a former student, Ethan Singer. And what we're going to do is we're going to use this micro trade data to examine indivisibilities, starting at the front end in Shenzhen, where most of Walmart's goods that are selling come from there, right? So these indivisibility things that I was focusing on, the last step of getting the store, there's a mirror image of that going on at the front end of the distribution process. Okay, and so we're going to quantify gains from scale with this micro data. Now, we're going to be looking at every container coming into the US. And how full is it? Is it half full, quarter full, three quarters full, et cetera, right? The cost of the container is the same no matter what. What I want to emphasize is it's more than just how full the boxes are, okay? Yeah, if it's half empty, you just doubled your transportation costs compared to what hypothetically what it would be if you used half as many containers, okay? Sure, that's a big deal. But on top of that, we're we going after the distortion incurred to fill the boxes, right? So what if you see if firms are selling the things 80% full? Well, to ensure that happens, they don't have the delivery frequency they might otherwise would have had, right? And so that's kind of a cost. So part of the trick of this paper is to try to get at that as well. And let me just make a confession. You know, thinking about what Amazon was going to do and online, say back, you know, I've been thinking about these things for decades now, right? I published a paper in 2001 related to it. And I just thought, well, you know, with online sales, it's going to neutralize Walmart's scale advantage in logistics, right? Because if you saw at the time what, you know, in the early 2000s, your online merchandiser, you know, what are you doing? You focus on your website, right? Your distribution is UPS, FedEx, you know, Postal Service, right? So all of this integrated distribution system that Walmart had would be increasingly irrelevant, right? We start seeing fragmentation. Boy, I got that wrong. Should have bought stock in Amazon in 2000, right? Amazon is increasingly dominant as it's vertically integrating into distribution and really doing what Walmart did, right? And here is the thing that's astonishing, really. Where we would have thought this, the small online firms are using Amazon for fulfillment, right? I mean, products that Amazon doesn't even carry. They register with Amazon, and Amazon gives them a code, right? And it just gets swept into Amazon's integrated distribution system. Right, which is very different than working with, you know, UPS or the Postal Service, right? It's some sort of, you know, arm's length transaction and let to see. So I'd be curious about what, you know, Cardinal Health is doing in terms of how much the computers are talking to each other about what's in the boxes, right? Because with Amazon, it's almost like you're at the website, you often don't even know whether it's Amazon or not. And of course, they tell you if you want to look for it, right? But it's an integrated operation. It's not just some small town furniture store selling their stuff through FedEx, getting stuff through FedEx, and the FedEx truck is picking up a bunch of different boxes, right? Like you can think of DHL. There are businesses, of course, will consolidate containers, right? You know, there's a business called the less than container load business. Right? But I'm going to show you that's relatively small. Right? Most small businesses, when they get a container shipped to them, it's for them. It's their stuff. There's all kinds of frictions that happen when your stuff combines with other stuff. For example, suppose that they screwed up their paperwork with the import stuff. Then your box gets held up just like theirs. Right? And there's the issue of theft, all kinds of things. It's very nice if I'm buying stuff from Asia to get from the factory, packed in the factory in Asia, to my factory, and not have to, I mean, it's like Uber Pool. Does anyone here ever use that?
Only right? By accident.
Pardon me, by accident you may use it, right? But there are major frictions. You think, oh, I'll just come in, I'll be an entrepreneur, I'll create this thing where these two people go to the airport, Well, one's over there, one's over there, one's in the bathroom, and there's just these kinds of frictions compared to doing it yourself, right? What I'm telling you is that same thing is happening with in the retail sector with getting goods, right? And so instead of having these intermediaries coming out to do this, you're having like these large firms doing the whole thing themselves from start to finish. Okay, so first of all, we're going to present some descriptive evidence with this unique data, right? I mean, every box coming into this country, right, I see, you know, and, you know, subject to some measurement error, I see how full they are because people are reporting like the cubic meters of that shipment, right? And that's sort of the relevant criterion. Most of the stuff coming from China, it's not about weight. It's about filling up the box, right? When these things, you know, Walmart's importing stuff, they're maybe a quarter of the weight limit. So this is all about volume. And I'm going to show you that the large firms, they are shipping full boxes, and they're doing extensive consolidation, right? So for a subset of my firms, I'm able to have product level data, and I can see the consolidation that's taking place. Small firms, I'm going to show, are shipping often half empty boxes, or using half-size containers, which there's a real premium for using. And I'm going to have evidence that the intermediaries, I mean, they exist, but the consolidation that they're doing across firms is fairly small. We're going to develop and estimate a structural model of indivisibility costs, right? And we're going to find that indivisibility costs, even bite for Walmart, coming out of some of the other Asian countries besides China, where their volumes are low. And one issue is Walmart has an everything travels the same way distribution system for stuff coming from Asia, right? So I live in Minneapolis. I know how the stuff gets there, right? Because, I mean, it's coming, half the time stuff coming from China is coming from Shenzhen, and it goes to Seattle, gets put on a train, gets put to, you know, Chicago, where there's an import distribution center, gets unpacked, put in a truck to go to a regional distribution center in Wisconsin, and then comes to the Walmart store, which actually I don't go to, but if I did, that's where I would get the stuff. And it's a very efficient way to get, you know, tens, hundreds of thousands of goods on the shelves at 3,500 stores, this system. But what it's going to bite some Asian sources like India, where they have to cut. So in other words, what they're doing is they're cutting up all shipments multiple ways to lower transportation costs in the U.S., like the ground transportation. And so the effect is you're cutting up things five ways, creating a tension with indivisibilities, right? The smaller your shipments, the harder it is to fill boxes, right? And so anyway, what we're going to do is we do simulations of the model. We're going to put Elizabeth Warren in our paper and have her come in and bust up Walmart 50-50. And we're going to get relatively tight bounds on increased costs, 4 to 5%, that'll be in a sec, of ocean freight. And given the thin profit margins now, with some discussion about profit margins, my understanding is Walmart profit margins are an order of 2% of sales, right? And so transportation costs are an order of 3% of sales, right? And we're only looking at just one part of the supply chain, right? So these the indivisibilities are going to show throughout the system, right, including at the last end, right? There was a question.
I was wondering, you know, what's the technological reason for not eating boxes that are half the size?
Pardon me? Oh, well, you can use half the size, but they cost 25%, 30% more to use them. So you can use a half-size box, but they cost more. They're not half.
They cost more per unit of capacity.
Yeah, per unit of capacity. Yeah, they're cheaper, but per unit shipped, they're 25-30% more, or actually a little more than that. But to be conservative, we're going to use 25%.
Is that about like picking them up and putting them in?
Well, there's some fixed costs of picking it up. There's also complicated things about the relative demand and supply going two different directions of this. From the firm's perspective, when they look out and what they can, if they use a half size, you pay 25% more per volume.
Put it out of bounds on, you know, some of these things.
Well, but now how do you fill out the half size one? So that's the problem. They're using a half-size one, but they're not filling that. Right? That's what we're going to... And sort of the rule of thumb in the business is if you can fill a half-size one half full, you might as well do that than trying to get involved with less container load. Okay? And so I'll show you that they're using half-size ones half full. Right? And you can't get quarter sizes. Okay? All right. And then the second thing we're going to do is we're going to... and I see I'm burning time up on, and I still in the intro. We're going to give... So Amazon, the way I described about what Walmart's doing with this one size fits all, everything gets there the same way, Amazon just does this completely free for all. They do whatever they... Each good has its own thing. Some, you know, expensive goods that are expensive to ship locally, they come in multiple coasts. Others just come one way. And we're going to show this flexibility as value. That's going to be the second counterfactual. Okay, so here's the model that we're going to estimate. Yes?
The size of this box set was optimized in some way.
Right.
I understand that there's only one.
Yeah.
But I mean, that was optimized too, right? That
yes.
was the size.
Yeah.
So do you actually find that? That is the right size on average
well,
or something?
Well, I mean, let's think about why the box is what it is. There is often these things get put on a rack and pulled around the roads, right? And so that's really related to what the indivisibility is. I mean, you can't make them twice as long, they wouldn't work on the highways.
I mean, there's a limit to how big they can be, I understand that.
Yeah.
You can make them smaller, for sure.
Well, you did make them smaller half size, but then there's some fixed cost of lifting them off.
Optimization there.
There is. Now, there's lots of moving parts deciding. I mean, there's also like a standard got set in the 70s, and people designed cranes and so forth. So the size of this box predates the information technologies that we have today, right? Walmart's not going to say, you know what, I have a proposal. Let's make the boxes like, I mean, actually they did. They added a foot to the... That's easy to do, right? The ships can be the same thing, and let's just add it one thing high. That's a response to China, right? Because they're not filling up the weight. They're hitting the cubic, the volume before the weight, so they make it 1 foot taller.
Just to follow up on what Esteban was asking, so, take from your answer, like there should be no presumption maybe that like the full constellation of trucks, cranes, road regulations, blah, 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 has delivered anything like... an optimal container.
Right, because there's huge network issues about getting to a standardized thing, right? I mean, look, predating containers, we didn't have these indivisibilities, right? You could bring whatever box you wanted and they would find a way to stick it in the ship, right? Right? It was just packed separately, okay? So containerization was a major benefit because you could do the packing away from the ship, right? But potentially has some costs. Now we have to, as we pack this away from a ship and get the benefits of the container that now we can put a padlock on it, we have to make sure to fill it up, right? And that's the tension. And I'm also I want to push that this isn't just about containers coming in from Shenzhen. There's the mirror images of this thing. I mean, the boxes are almost the same size, but going from the regional distribution center to the final delivery at the store.
My point is just that the average costs are going to vary a lot depending on what size you choose for that one.
It will.
Box, right?
I have not. Okay, so there's yet another paper that potentially could be written. If we were to go back in the 1970s and say, should we add 2 feet or 5 feet or, you know, in meters versus feet? Okay. All right. So now we're going to have to put a model down in front of you. This would be outright rejected if this was about a logistics conference. This is just going to be an abstraction about how to think about inventories ordering decisions. So let's just bear with me. It's going to be we'll start with a planning problem for a particular product, like an SKU, right? It's a barcode level product. And we're just going to take the volume of that as exogenous. And then the question is, how do we get it to our stores? Right, we can decide, and let's just take advantage of using a continuum. So we're just going to assume there's a large number of deliveries over the course of a year, and we're going to pick a measure delivery, right? So it's like, this is a big number. We're getting very frequent deliveries. A small number, not so much. Okay, and we're going to have a weighting cost. So there's going to be a preference for variety. We're going to use just a sort of the quadratic structure to get a preference for variety, right? And it's going to scale up. There's going to be a parameter phi that's going to govern it, as well as a, if there's twice as much total volume, of course, the weighting costs are going to scale proportionally if you hold fixed the variety. Now, of course, what's going to happen is for higher volume goods, you're going to have more deliveries, right? And so you need greater variety. I mean, you can think of this as just like, and there's order costs. So I'm going to put some reason why, even with no indivisibilities, there's some other fixed costs lurking in the system, why, say, Walmart, which has really hammered down invisibility costs, they still, they don't get deliveries every day, right, coming from China, right? So there's going to be some other fixed costs floating in the system, right? And the ones we're going to be focusing on are the ones related to box sizes, okay? But just to sort of benchmark thing, suppose we have no indivisibilities, right? And so just the way when you go shopping sometimes, you're in the grocery store and they're at the batch candy section, right? Where you just get a scooper and you put it in a bag and your price is, if it's $2 a pound, if you get a pound and a half, it's just proportional to how much you do, right? Well, imagine that's how shipping worked, right? Well, what you would do is you'd pick some delivery frequency, it's perfectly smooth across there, and you would get a profit. You'd have to take out your weighting cost, which is you'd have to this bit here is your total volume times the cost per unit, right? And then you have this fixed cost. Order cost thing, which will depend upon the volume of the delivery frequency, right? And if you just take first order condition of the problem, you get this sort of square root rule relating variety to volume. Right?
That's Baumol-Tobin.
Yes, of course. It's exactly Baumol-Tobin. Of course it is. Yes. Yes.
Repurposed.
Yes, repurposed. Yes. Thank you, Macrofield. Which is applied micro, as you mentioned. But now let's put in the indivisibilities. And what I, okay, what this is the actual order that was optimal, not thinking about box sizes. And I mean, in the general model, this can be any number, but just for the sake of this discussion, let's just assume that if we didn't think about indivisibilities, right, if the pricing was just, like if it's $3,000 to ship a container, if it's let's do 4,000, even that's a little high. If it's 3/4 full, you'd only have to pay 3,000. If it was 1/4 full, you'd pay 1,000, right? And let's just say, in that environment, your optimal shipping size would just be, 0.72 container, or, right, is your unit. Okay. Well, we got to deal with that now because we do have the indivisibilities. All right. And so here's how we're going to model. All right. There is a technology for consolidation. Right. You want to send 0.72 of a container. Oh, you can send it over to the consolidation operation, but there's a friction. Maybe you have to, even within the same company, you have to pull from different locations. The timing. Right? So yeah, this is ready to go. 0.72 container. Oh, I know we can combine it. Well, wait, that's going to be ready next week. Oh, so we sit and wait. Okay? We are going to bundle all of those frictions into a number, eta, which will be some friction, some extra cost. It's going to be an endogenous variable, right? We're going to estimate this thing. Okay? And it's going to be based on revealed preference. I mean, the fact that you're not consolidating all the time is going to be pretty good evidence that it exists, right? Because once we see containers being shipped 3/4 full, if this thing were zero, why are they doing that? Just consolidate away. Okay, so we're also going to have some random stuff. For a given shipment, well, maybe consolidation's good or bad. There's some, like you hear, there's some particular good reason, and maybe this would so for this particular shipment, we're going to draw a shock epsilon U, which means unconsolidated is a good option. We're going to get extra benefit from doing it that way, or consolidated. Just the usually random stuff, so things don't perfectly fit here, right? And we're assuming it's type 1 extreme value, right? And we're going to scale it so that there's going to be no way to like jiggle things to get, you know, this option value, which thing you do to be something that's driving results, right? So things are, this whole thing is just going to scale up. I mean, if I have twice as many deliveries, these shocks are going to be half as big, so I'm not going to create value from having more options because the gains from the shocks are going to be half as big. Okay, and here's another thing. Now, I have to say that the way I write down this model is a bit of reverse engineering, right? So the paper you have is we got this reduced form, and now, you know, we're revising it, and we're reverse engineering to get the model to get the reduced form. So we're going to make this assumption here that I don't think is too crazy, but it's just a technical thing that's going to make this a model easy to work with. So what we're going to do is we're going to say your consolidation quantity that you're going to use, you pick before realizations, before you see the realizations of epsilon and U, and you have to stick with them. And furthermore, there's some chance that even if you just send it out on its own box, you're stuck with this quantity X, okay? But there's some chance, probability omega, that you're now going to be flexible, and you can say, oh, well, we don't have to pay that friction. We'll just tweak things to fill the box, okay? And so this parameter omega is going to be important because it's going to govern how easy it is for you to make adjustments, okay? And I don't have a lot of time, but I think I should just say something about the model so when I give you some numbers, you know what it is I'm reporting, right? And so this now is the planning problem for a particular good, right? Where you're basically deciding variety, X is this number of what you do if the shipment arrives and you want to consolidate, you're going to plan to consolidate it. Y is this shipment level that, you know, the shipment arrives and you choose to just send it in its own box so you don't have to pay the consolidation friction, and you've got that flexibility shock that you're allowed to do that, okay? And rules, right? So in this model, there's going to be like a manager at the plant who's going to be seeing these shocks and deciding what to do, right? And so, you know, you're going to need rules, right? And those rules are going to give you some probabilities, which will depend on whether you have the flexibility thing have been hurt or whether there's no flexibility, right? And so then, when you pick these quantities and these decision rules, right, you better deliver the quantity you're planning to deliver for the year. So just imagine this is what we need to go, and these are the number of varieties, okay? And so this is the probability you can be flexible, and so this is the event that you are flexible, but just because you're flexible doesn't mean you want to consolidate and adjust things. And so depending on the epsilon shocks, you're going to have some probability that you consolidate. And this is the probability you can't be flexible. And so whatever, you got to stick with X because you can't change things. You're just going with X. It doesn't matter whether you consolidate or not. And then this is the volume of times where you are flexible and you decide to send it in its own box so you don't consolidate, and then you use that particular Y, okay? Maybe I told you a little bit about how the model works, right? I just pointed to this constraint that you have to get this much delivered over the course of the year, right? And then I'm not gonna drag you through these additional equations, other to say that, you know, based on these volumes, that's going to determine the amount of weighting or, you know, the value of the diversity. And this thing is just the weighting cost as a function of those choices, right? But I want to point you to this thing, right? And so this is actually what you're paying for transportation, right? And so conditioned on consolidating, you're just whatever that volume is times the friction, okay? 15 minutes, right. And over here, this is just the boxes. You're paying for the whole box, okay? Right, remember Y is how much is in the box, or X if you're stuck and can't consolidate, or you can't adjust, but you're paying for the whole box, and so that's not showing up here, right? And so, you know, you think about putting Lagrange multipliers on here and so forth, there's going to be a value, right, when you've got a box that's partially empty, to stick a little more in, right, because the marginal cost of putting more in that box is zero. Right, and so you know, you're gonna maybe not a surprise, but obviously, conditional on you're sending it, you're not consolidating. You can put the shipment size is going to be bigger. You're going to try to fill up that box. Okay, indivisibility cost is low in this model when the friction is low. When flexibility is high, right? Because I can adjust to match the size of the boxes, or if you your initial shipment was you wanted to send 7 containers for 7.2. You just can, it's only to round down to get the right size is relatively trivial, right? So firms that just have very, very large shipments, this stuff's not going to be important. Okay, just some more details of the model. We're going to allow for cutting up deliveries over space as well as time. We get why having very frequent deliveries is going to be desirable because you can adjust to demand and so forth. But by cutting deliveries over space, you can save transportation costs, right? So, you know, the big retailers are bringing stuff in, not just on the East Coast and the West Coast, but also the Gulf, right, to sort of lower ground transportation, which is expensive relative to ocean transportation, okay? So, and so in this analysis, when we were talking about, like, this problem, this is for a particular good, right? Every good is going to have their own, you know, delivery frequency thing, right? But when we're deciding how often to cut up in geographic space, it's going to be the same for Walmart and Target and so forth. It's going to be the same for all goods. Okay, finally, what else are we going to put in here? Scale economies and consolidation. Right. If you have a greater total volume, we're going to allow for the fact that it's going to be the friction is going to get smaller, right? Because more volume. Remember, I told you what the problem was, right? You can combine with that other good, but you have to wait 2 weeks. Well, there's just more volume. The chances you're going to be able to match and get this thing filled up exactly quick is going to be higher. And so this is a parameter we're going to go after. Okay. So quick on data. The Customs and Border Protection distributes records for waterborne imports. For some reason, there's a grandfathering in where this, if it's by air, you don't get it, by ground, you don't get it, but you can get a shipping manifest. I mean, it's $100 a day to buy it. I actually bought some recently. This other stuff I bought through resellers. But in any case, here's an example record. It's a bill of lading, it's a receipt, and here, one reason why this stuff doesn't get used is because people are redacting like crazy, right? So the shipper redacted, consignee redacted. But if you do a lot of legwork, you can figure out to a large extent which firms are which, right? I mean, here in this case, Walmart actually put its name on some other record that's not redacted, right? And so what I'm getting here, which is good for what I want to do, is I have what's in the box. I've got a barcode number right here. I've got the actual containers being used, and you know, I have the volume, right? And so this particular example is not a great one for indivisibilities because this particular microwave, they had like 1,000 shipments, like I think twice a month for all the distribution centers, right? And then shipment size is 7 or 8, so not relevant, right? But this is atypical for Walmart, right? If you just looked over barcodes, your typical barcode ships to less than half a container the whole country in a whole year. Okay? So if you didn't consolidate, you would your transportation costs would explode. Okay? So let me just show you the facts. Consolidation by mass discount is significant, and small firms it's not. But here, this is, I have 10 minutes left, right? So this is just a histogram, like, of how much is in a box coming from China across all firms. And yes, somebody was talking about the half-size boxes. You can see them here, right? And they hold about 30 feet, and you can see that a lot of them are half full, okay? And then of the full-size boxes, and there's, I told you that there's the thing where they add the extra foot, so there's two peaks here. But you can see that there's just all of this stuff coming in with, you know, partial containers.
Can I ask a good question? Yeah. So what's the, how does it work with the ships? I
mean, like, the what?
With the ships. I mean, I assume can Walmart food that for the ship, or is that
not
too much?
I mean, sometimes Walmart has... There's also indivisibilities in ships.
Yeah, that's what.
But that I think it's not that big an issue, especially.
What's the mass that's to the right of the biggest peak? So they're like extra large.
Yeah, there's a couple extra large, 45 footers, but they're rare, and there's a little bit measurement error. But this is Walmart, right? So that's the first point I want you to see is they don't have any of this stuff, right? They're filling their boxes using the most cost efficient sizes, right? This is out of China. Now we see Walmart out of India, right? And because they are cutting things up five ways out of India, just like they do out of Shenzhen, they're having box. They're going to have to use some half sizes, half full.
What's the regular size?
Pardon me?
The regular size?
It's 40 foot. But with stuff from Asia, it's called a high cube because they add an extra foot. Consolidation. Here's the fact. Walmart is, sure, there's stuff like that in microwave, maybe half of containers or part of shipments that are more than one container, the same stuff is coming in, right? But fully 42% of stuff coming out of China, 75% of stuff coming out of Bangladesh is consolidation happening in the container, right? With multiple products, sometimes in different product groups. This is my fact about like small firms. So I can pull out the small firms and I can, you know, there's less of a redaction issue. And I can ask them, how often are they working with intermediaries and being consolidated with other firms' products? That's the consolidation I'm talking about here. Multiple firms in the same box. And you take a firm that just sends one shipment a year and only 9% of the containers are consolidated, okay? So, you know, and of course, as they get bigger, it's even less, right? So the small firm sector is generally just using their own box, half size. Okay, I'm gonna skip that. And so, you know, we're gonna estimate this model. What we're gonna do is we're gonna assume this eta is fixed at each location, right? Because different locations have different volumes, right? And so it will be endogenous in the thing, but it's going to be, given the volume that's being determined, well, we said we're gonna split things up five ways or one way or so forth, there's gonna be a certain friction at each location, and we're gonna estimate that. I'm rapidly running out of time, and so I want to just tell you, just so you have a sense of what I'm doing here. We got a model with parameters that's going to generate. We're going to be throwing shipment sizes to somebody at Shenzhen, a product manager at the loading dock, deciding what to do. Okay, there's a probabilistic structure, right? People begin, you know, we have a parameter governing epsilon shocks, right? We're going to estimate that, right? We're going to have frictions for consolidating, right? And we're going to estimate the model separately for each location, source, right? Because the agglomeration benefits might vary across the different sources. And what moments are we going to be looking at? Well, like the share consolidated, right? How often are you consolidating goods, right? If we see that they're just consolidating all the time, right, then we think that friction may be fairly low. We're going to be looking at the size distribution of the shipments we see, because remember, firms are reacting conditioned on consolidating versus non-consolidating. They're making decisions about, well, maybe I put more in the container. You know, let me react. I'm flexible, so let me round up the shipment size so I can fit it in the container. That's going to help govern that. And of course, just the mean empty space in unconsolidated shipments is going to be a parameter that we're going to a moment of the data we want to fit. And so we estimate this model. Each firm, each origin, separate, because that's going to govern the volume coming from the origin, the opportunities for consolidation. And the parameter I want to focus on here is this friction eta. So even for Walmart, which in the end, coming out of China, tends to have, you know, about maybe a 3% empty, right? So there looks like they're doing great, right? And they're doing all the consolidation, but we're backing out that consolidation involves frictions, real frictions. And then coming out of Mumbai, it's 47%, right? I mean, you can almost get a bound on that, because you can see they're using half-size containers. If they waited and consolidate, they could avoid the penalty of using a half-size. They're doing it all the time, right? That friction must be real and big. And then what we do is we just plot the different originations and just, you know, like Shenzhen's up here, Mumbai's down here, and you can just, it just lines up that, you know, the higher volume locations have lower frictions, right? Now, we can also do this stuff over time, and here is just the Christmas effect. Coming out of Shenzhen, we can estimate the model separately for each two-month period, right? And you can see Christmas, well, Christmas is here. Now, in this business, Christmas is really in September and October, because you're loading up all the, you know, it takes a while to get to the stores, right? And of course, I know even at Christmas, I mean, by October and September, you actually do see Christmas trees at Target and so forth, right? And so you can see the volume and in September and October is twice what it is the rest of the year, okay? Now let's just estimate the model in each two-month period, and you just see a perfectly inverted relationship between volume and frictions, right? The higher the volume is, easier to consolidate, right? And either way you do it, you get the same semi-elasticity just about. So that, right, so from relating the consolidation friction to volume. So now what do we do? Well, we're going to estimate the indivisibility costs each origin. Walmart out of Shenzhen, and this is a rate, this is relative to ocean freight. So you can think of it as adding a 10%. It would be like equivalent if you could either live in a world with no indivisibilities, but you pay 10.3% more per for your rate. Okay, that's what you can think about this number, right? And that's with Walmart cutting things up five ways, which is what they do, right? If they instead were to just send everything through LA, they would enjoy the benefits of greater scale sending everything to LA, but they'd blow up their transportation costs, right? And so, the friction would go down, but the your transportation costs would go up. And in terms of simulating, we actually predict that in this trade-off between transportation costs and indivisibilities, Walmart would want to use five, you know, where we use the information about transportation costs, Walmart would in fact use five import distribution centers, which is what they do. We didn't use that in our estimation. Target is very similar to Walmart, but naturally they're a little bit smaller and have higher indivisibility costs. And small firms, they just have really big indivisibility costs. Okay, now I got to do a counterfactual. I got to have Elizabeth Warren show up, and she'll, even though she would see that it's 0 minutes, she would keep talking. And she's saying, I'm cutting them up. And so we did. And so what we see is And so there's a lot going on in this number. So let me just say, if they just did what they were doing, cut in half, and now we would just keep our delivery frequency the same, how often we cut it in space the same. That would be one calculation. But that's not what we should be thinking about, right? Because if Elizabeth Warren does split this company up, they'll optimally respond and change their inventories. And so these numbers, that's why you have to have bounds, but that it takes into account that there's other stuff going on in the background besides Indivisibilities, like waiting costs and transportation costs inland and all that stuff. And we get this number, which is, I think, is a pretty big number. I mean, this is Walmart. I think Walmart's enormous, right? What difference does it make to Walmart if we cut it in half when it's this monster firm for this particular thing? And then we see costs go up over, 3 to 4%. Right? So that's what I got. Because I've got nothing else because I have no time.
This is the transportation.
This is ocean transportation, but this is just one bit, right? So there's also the transportation.
Do you have an idea what is that as a fraction of the total cost?
Well, it's I can tell you the stuff coming from Asia, transportation cost is 8% on average for Walmart of total cost. Okay, so the microwave stuff that I showed you, that was 10%.
He's just making this is an example of the scale advantage that works for Walmart in 15 different markets.
Exactly, but Walmart, what are they good at? They're not, this stuff is not going to be relevant for diamond rings. Right, Walmart is this great technology for having large variety of really cheap stuff. Right, when your kids go to Halloween, there's so many different costumes because they have this efficient way to give this variety, right, for stuff that they're selling for a song. Right, and so that's a way to think about what Walmart's doing as opposed to like Costco and these other companies, where they don't give you hardly any variety. Right, Costco solves the indivisibility problem by just loading up a container full of one thing. You go to the store. This is, you want it? No, then go to another store. But Walmart has successfully figured out how to, and Amazon, by the way, is the same.
The way you split must change the answer to this.
Pardon me?
The way you split must change the answer.
Well, of course,
it, right? Like if you split Walmart into the five distribution centers,
then it would, in my model, it would have no effect.
Yeah.
What we're looking at. No, we're splitting it so that in each city you have to have two different Walmarts.
Yeah.
Okay, but then, I mean, again, I want to emphasize that this stuff, you're also going to Indivisibilities at the store, and we're not included in that, but absolutely right. If you have a Brexit in the U.S., or like we go back to 1860, where some of us would say, maybe we wish they would leave, but where am I? Oh, that's a bad place to be talking about that. But, splitting up by the Southeast, which is covered by one distribution center, the West another, and this model would have no effect.
I think we can.
Yep, we've stopped.
We can recombine at 11.
Okay.